Hello everyone, and thanks for watching Edupedia World Videos. So today we are finally starting with the liquid state, okay? And in that we'll focus mainly on vapor pressure in this session, right? So let's begin. Basically, we already know that liquid state is simply a result of combination of intermolecular forces, which are van der Waals forces and are assumed to be attractive in nature only, okay? Plus the repulsive forces, plus the thermal motion. Okay, so whether it is solid, liquid or gas, okay, the phase of any substance is determined by the sum of these three acting between the molecules. So in liquid state, the force is strong enough to keep the molecules close to one another, okay, and thermal motion is low. Okay, as a result, what you see is that the molecules are more densely packed than in comparison to vapor state. And as a result, you see the state called liquid state. Okay. Also here, since the molecules are close, they are so close that the repulsive forces are now acting between the molecules. As a result of which, it becomes very difficult to compress the liquids further. Okay. Since the repulsive forces are acting and they keep on increasing as you keep on trying to bring the molecules close to one another, the compression of liquid is very difficult, and hence even with high application of pressure, okay, application of high pressure, the change in volume is very, very low. Okay, delta V is very low. In fact, it is so low that in your syllabus, you will assume that delta V is nearly tending to zero. Okay, that is, liquids are incompressible. That is what you will assume in your syllabus. Okay, now we don't have to study liquid state in great detail. We'll only focus on three properties, namely vapor pressure, viscosity and surface tension. Of these three, vapor pressure is something that you will study in more detail in class 12th physical chemistry, and viscosity and surface tension are the properties which you will study in physics. Okay, so even these three, we'll just look at the definitions, maybe one or two graphs and or formula. Okay, but we won't go into details of any of these three properties. Okay, so let's wrap this up very quickly. So what is vapor pressure? It is simply the pressure, okay, or the equilibrium pressure exerted by vapor of a liquid on the topmost layer of a liquid. That is to say, let's say I have a container. In this container, there is nothing right now. It's a vacuum. And let's assume now I am able to pour some liquid inside this. Okay, so there is only liquid over here, all right, and there is nothing in the upper half of the container. All right, so we will assume that there is nothing in the upper half. That means the pressure in the upper half must still be zero, but it turns out that after some time we do happen to measure a value of pressure over here. So where does this pressure comes from? This pressure is a result of evaporation of the liquid molecules. Okay. So what happens is, this liquid, all right, it is basically a combination of various molecules, and these molecules, okay, are there everywhere from the topmost layer to the bottommost layer. And the molecules in the topmost layer, okay, they are more energetic, okay, in the topmost layer, like the only layer, okay, which is there at the top. Okay, it is filled with, say, a line of single molecules. Let's assume that. So these molecules are more energetic than the molecules in the layers below. In fact, they are so energetic that some of them are capable or have the capacity to vaporize and convert themselves into vapor phase. Right. So basically, when you are converting liquid to vapor, what do you need? You need to supply energy. You need to supply heat. That is what we know as heat of vaporization. Okay, or enthalpy of vaporization. So this latent heat, all right, or this enthalpy of vaporization might already be present with the molecules in the topmost layer, as a result of which these molecules, okay, can evaporate and convert themselves into vapor phase. Now these molecules which are converted into vapor phase are going to show random motion. Okay, we can assume them to be ideal gas molecules, and these molecules are going to randomly move around in the container wherever there is empty space. We can apply all the gaseous laws over here. Okay, and so PV is equal to nRT. Let's assume that for simplicity for now, though we know it is not an ideal gas. These molecules, okay, are going to randomly move, collide, okay, and do all that what we have studied in gaseous state, as a result of which these molecules will also collide back with the topmost layer of the liquid, okay, and hence they will exert some force on the layer of the liquid. And if you are able to calculate this force upon cross sectional area of your liquid layer, okay, you get the pressure exerted by vaporized molecules on the liquid. So this pressure exerted by vaporized molecules is called vapor pressure of the liquid. But the thing is, vapor pressure is defined only at equilibrium. Okay, so how does that equilibrium gets there? Okay, how is equilibrium achieved and what we are actually talking about, we'll see in the next slide. Just remember that vapor pressure is a thermodynamic quantity, okay, and it is an intensive property, that is, it doesn't depend on mass or size of the container or the amount of liquid that you have, okay, it depends only on the temperature. Once the type of liquid is fixed for a given liquid, it depends only and only on temperature, nothing else. Let's see how the process takes place, okay, so we'll be able to understand what equilibrium we are talking about. See, what happens is, coming back to a container, alright, so initially you only have liquid. Initially we only have liquid over here with us, alright. So if you want to plot a graph, okay, so this graph represents, say, time on the x-axis. Okay. And on the y-axis, it has rate of physical change or the physical process, that is, here liquid is getting converted into vapor, so rate of evaporation, for example. Okay, what happens is, there is not only evaporation taking place over here. Okay, once the liquid molecules have the energy enough to go into vapor phase, okay, and say you had only one molecule of vapor phase over here, now you have two, now you have three. So these molecules, okay, they will start colliding with one another, alright, and they will start moving around. We know that each molecule in a gaseous phase can have a different velocity and hence a different amount of energy. So some molecules might lose their energy and convert back to liquid phase. That is, they might undergo a process of condensation. And this actually happens, okay, as soon as the vaporization starts and we have molecules in the vapor phase, okay, so right now we have only liquid, this liquid starts converting to vapor phase, and as soon as this vapor is formed, it has the ability to condense back into liquid phase, okay, and after this moment, both the processes simultaneously take place, evaporation, okay, in the forward direction, and condensation in the backward direction. Okay, once again, we are not going to go into further details. Okay, you will study this in class 12th. So just looking at this equilibrium, we know that there are two processes taking place here, two physical change. One is from liquid to vapor and the other is from vapor to liquid. So rate of evaporation, okay, that remains constant. Okay, rate of evaporation is dependent on the surface area of topmost layer, because evaporation is a surface phenomena, it only happens or occurs in the topmost layer of liquid. So greater the area of the topmost layer, more molecules will be able to go into vapor phase, and that remains constant over here because your container is fixed. Okay, so if the size of the container is fixed, rate of evaporation will be fixed, assuming the temperature is constant throughout. Okay, T is kept to be constant. All right so rate of evaporation is fixed, but the rate of condensation was initially zero because there were no molecules in vapor phase to condense back. Okay, and as the number of molecules in vapor phase keep on increasing, the rate of condensation will also keep on increasing. It will keep on increasing, and after some time the rate of condensation will become equal to rate of evaporation, because the number of molecules are in the vapor phase keep on increasing. But once this point is reached, okay, where rate of evaporation is equal to rate of condensation, at this point and after this point, the number of molecules going to the vapor phase will equal the number of molecules coming back to the liquid phase, and hence after these, the two will, okay, always remain to have the same constant value throughout. So at this point, you can say rate of forward direction Okay, rate of physical process in the forward direction is equal to the rate of physical process in the backward direction. This is your condition of equilibrium. So after this, there is an equilibrium in the system. And after this time T1, okay, after this time T1, when you measure the pressure exerted by molecules in vapor phase on the layers of liquid, the pressure will be called vapor pressure of liquid. Okay, it is called vapor pressure of liquid, not gas, because the pressure is exerted because of the molecules which have come from liquid phase. Okay, so before this point, before T1, the pressure exerted was not called vapor pressure, it was just pressure exerted. Okay, or you can say partial pressure of liquid. Okay, if in case there are more than one gas in the vapor phase. Alright, so this is just pressure over here, but once the equilibrium is achieved, that pressure is given a new name. Okay, it is called vapor pressure of a liquid. Okay, and it has a specific value at a given temperature for a given liquid. Okay, and that value changes only and only with temperature. The value of vapor pressure, that is the pressure at equilibrium exerted by molecules of liquid in the vapor phase, has a fixed value at a given temperature. Okay, so you have to remember this. Alright. So this is what we were trying to study over here. Let's look at the graph of vapor pressure with temperature, since I told you that vapor pressure only changes with temperature. So let's say you have temperature on the x-axis, okay, temperature in Kelvin, and let's say we have pressure P on the y-axis, okay. So the pressure can be in mm of Hg or say atm, let's say it is in mm of Hg, okay. So the pressure, okay, it starts with, let's say from here, okay, let's assume from here, and the nature of the curve is usually like this, okay, pretty much for all the liquids. Some liquids can show a bit variations, but the nature of the curve is more or less similar from liquid to liquid. So let's say we are talking about water over here, okay. So as I keep on increasing the temperature, that is, as I keep on going on the right hand side on the x-axis, my vapor pressure, okay, this is vapor pressure, not just pressure, that is the pressure calculated at equilibrium. My vapor pressure of the liquid also keeps on increasing. So let's say it is 0 over here, okay, then 0.1 atm over here, let's assume that, okay, 0.2 atm, 0.3 atm, okay, it is 0.5 atm over here. Alright, so instead of mm of Hg, we are taking, let's say, atm, or you can even take bar or pascal, any unit you like, okay, and so on, 0.6 atm, 0.7, and let's say this is 1 atmosphere, okay, and it can even be more than that, 1.5 atmosphere, so on and so forth, okay. So as you keep on increasing temperature, the vapor pressure will keep on increasing, okay, and this is true for every liquid, right. So okay, right now, this is your container, okay, and this is your liquid. Let's say the container is open right now, and I'm increasing the temperature of the container and the surrounding area. As a result of that, the vapor pressure will keep on increasing. Okay. Finally, there will come a point, okay, initially vapor pressure was zero, let's say zero or very low. So there will finally come a point when vapor pressure will become equal to the pressure of the surrounding area. Okay, in our case, the surrounding area might be the atmosphere. That means there might come a time when vapor pressure becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure, that is at this point. So at this point, okay, this point was achieved at the temperature T, let's call it TB. Okay, so this temperature at which vapor pressure of a given liquid becomes equal to the surrounding pressure is called the boiling point of that liquid. So why is this given a special name? Because at this temperature and after this temperature, it won't only be the topmost layer that gets evaporated. Okay, we know that evaporation is a surface phenomenon. It only takes place from the topmost layer of the liquid, but after this point, okay, once the vapor pressure becomes equal to the surrounding pressure, the liquid throughout the bulk, okay, from topmost layer to the bottommost layer, will start forming bubbles or will start vaporizing. Okay, this is because now the vapor pressure is sufficient enough to overcome the pressure exerted by surrounding air. Okay, and hence the molecules of liquid are free to escape now in the vapor phase or towards the vapor phase. Okay, so this phenomena, when vaporization is taking place throughout the bulk of the liquid and not just on the topmost layer, is called boiling. Okay, this is how boiling is defined. It is simply vaporization taking place throughout the bulk, and hence the temperature at which this occurs or this starts is called the boiling point of the liquid. Okay, so you should know this, the difference between vaporization or evaporation and boiling. So boiling is a bulk phenomena, it happens throughout the bulk substance, but vaporization only occurs in the topmost layer of the molecules, right? So for different liquids this phenomena of vapor pressure becoming equal to the surrounding pressure will happen at different times. Okay, and hence boiling points of different liquids are different. For example, for water, if the surrounding pressure is 1 atmosphere, then this is likely to happen at 100 degrees centigrade or 373 Kelvin. And hence the boiling point of water comes out to be 373 Kelvin or 100 degree centigrade. Okay, so this is how you find out boiling point. Okay, so that's all you need to know about vapor pressure actually. Okay, so let's look at some more things, some more analysis. Now there are terms called normal boiling point and standard boiling point which you must know. So they are very simple actually. We know that boiling occurs when vapor pressure of any given liquid is equal to pressure of the surrounding area. Alright, and the pressure of the surrounding area can be anything. Okay, it can be any value that we want. Okay, we can keep the container in a surrounding area of pressure 0.5 atm or 2 atm or 10 atm. Right. So if the pressure of the surrounding area is equal to or happens to be equal to 1 atmosphere, then the boiling point is called normal boiling point. Okay, so it has a special name, normal boiling point. And if the pressure of the surrounding area comes out to be equal to 1 bar, then the boiling point or the temperature at which vapor pressure becomes equal to 1 bar for any given liquid, not just water, for any given liquid, it is called standard boiling point. Okay, so this is the difference between normal boiling point and standard boiling point. Normal boiling point is when surrounding pressure is 1 atmosphere. Standard boiling point is when surrounding pressure is 1 bar. Okay, and if the surrounding pressure has any other value, then it is simply called boiling point of the liquid. It is not called normal boiling point or standard boiling point. Now there is another term that you must know, volatile and non-volatile liquids or volatile and non-volatile solids. Okay, so see, vapor pressure, though we are studying for liquids, is also defined for solids. Okay, which seems to be surprising, but yeah, it happens. So volatile liquids are the liquids which have high vapor pressure. Okay, so they have high vapor pressure, that is their tendency to stay in vapor phase is high. Okay, when will the vapor pressure be high? When the vaporization or evaporation is more, as a result of which the molecules in vapor phase are more and hence they are able to exert more pressure. Okay, that can be one reason. So volatile liquids are the liquids for which vapor pressures have high values, and whereas non-volatile liquids or substances are the liquids or substances with low values of vapor pressure. Okay, so what does high vapor pressure means? It means that even at low temperatures, okay, so this is the temperature versus vapor pressure graph. So for volatile liquids, even at low temperatures, the vapor pressure will be somewhere here. Okay, and it will go like this. For non-volatile liquids, it might be like this. Okay, even if you increase the temperature to very high values, vapor pressure will be very, very low. Okay, and hence, for volatile liquids, the temperature at which vapor pressure becomes, okay, equal to atmospheric pressure, okay, will be low. And hence, we can say for volatile liquids, boiling points are low. Whereas for non-volatile liquids, vapor pressure is low and hence boiling points will be high. Okay, so for example, acetone, ether, they are more volatile than water and hence their boiling points are lower than that of water. Okay, so this is another thing that you needed to know. Lastly, vapor pressure of water has another specific name. It is also known as aqueous tension of water, okay, or simply aqueous tension. So whenever you hear this term, aqueous tension is nothing but vapor pressure of water. For all the other liquids, you simply use the term vapor pressure. For water, you can use the term aqueous tension. Alright, so this finishes up the topic of vapor pressure. In the next session, we'll study viscosity and then surface tension. Okay, and that will wrap up the chapter of states of matter. So, until next time, and once again, thanks for watching Edupedia World Videos.